Rajan, Governor, Reserve Bank of India, Dr. Ishar Aluwalia, Chairperson, ICRA, Board of Governors, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, a very warm welcome to the 6th K.B. Lal Memorial Lecture on India and Global Finance to be delivered by Governor Raghuram Rajan. Before we start, may I request Vatsala to please welcome the governor with a bouquet. We'll have Dr. Aluwalia chair the proceedings, then the governor will make a speech, then we'll have a question answer session, and then we'll close. So may I request Dr. Ishar Aluwalia to please chair the proceedings.
Dr. Raghuram Rajan, Governor, Reserve Bank of India, and former member of the governing body of ICRA, distinguished members of the Board of Governors and members of ICRA, Dr. Rajiv Lal, Mr. Ashok Lal, Ms. Veenu Shah, Ms. Ranjana Pandey, and other members of the Lal family, friends and faculty of ICRA, distinguished guests, Dr. Rajat Kathuria, Director and Chief Executive of ICRA, a very warm welcome to all of you on the occasion of the 6th K.B. Lal Memorial Lecture by Dr. Rajan. Dr. K.B. Lal Memorial Lecture is a flagship event of ICRA, and we have been very fortunate in getting extremely eminent persons to come and speak in this series. Professor Mike Spence, Nobel Laureate in Economics, Dr. Larry Summers, former Treasury of the Secretary of the US, Dr. Mervyn King, former Governor of the Bank of England, Dr. Andrew Sheng, former Chairman, Singapore Monetary Authority, and Professor David Vines from Oxford University have delivered the earlier lectures. This, our 6th K.B. Lal Memorial Lecture, is very special for two reasons. First, it is Dr. K.B. Lal's 100th birth anniversary. Precisely at the end of this month, on the 30th, he would have turned 101. And second, we have our very own Dr. Raghuram Rajan to deliver this lecture. I'd like to say a few words about Dr. Lal and also a few words on ICRA. Dr. K.B. Lal, as many of you know, was a visionary. He was ahead of his times. He set up ICRA in 1981 at a time when most policy-oriented research institutes in India took it for granted that India was a closed economy and was unlikely to change. Dr. Lal saw the need for integration with the world economy, and he said, "We need an institution which will focus on research on international economic relations." He saw how and why our economic policy and foreign policy must come together. Many of us remember Dr. Lal as Defense Secretary during the critical years of early 1970s when the Bangladesh War happened. We remember him as Commerce Secretary soon thereafter. But even I was not aware of the fact that in 1948, Dr. K.B. Lal worked with Sardar Patel to look after the riot victims in Delhi. He also played a major role working with V.P. Menon in the integration of the Madhya Bharat states as the Indian nation came together. It is interesting that Dr. Lal started his career integrating India, by the end of his career, he was looking to ways of integrating India with the rest of the world. He recognized that we need research in order to make a successful transition from a closed economy to a confident open economy, finding our rightful place in the global setup. As ambassador of India to the European Economic Community, he brought forth the concept of economic partnership with the EEC. In his speech at the presentation of his credentials to the president of EEC in March 1962, he observed, "This seems to us an event of some importance because it is the first time that relations of this character are being established between the community and a developing country in Asia. We have come a long way from that to the EU, with whom we now have a strategic partnership and hope to sign an FTA soon." We at ICRIER are very conscious that our founder chairman had high hopes of ICRIER. We hope that we can live up to his expectations. In this 100th birth anniversary of Dr. K. Bilal, I would like to share three landmarks that ICRIER has achieved. First, we are launching this year a three-year program on global competitiveness of the Indian economy, funded jointly by IDFC and its affiliates, and Dr. Rajiv Lal in his personal capacity. A grant of ₹1.5 crore has been given to ICRIER for this purpose. The second landmark that I would like to share with you is that at ICRIER now, for some time, we have been moving towards greater focus on urbanization, the challenges and opportunities, and also climate change and sustainability issues. In fact, we have added these two as thrust areas in our 9 thrust areas that we have for research at ICRIER. To take our work on urbanization forward, I'm happy to announce here that Mr. Shardul Shroff has endowed a chair on urbanization at ICRIER in the memory of his parents, Suresh and Bharati Shroff. So we now have a chair on Suresh and Bharati chair on urbanization at ICRIER, fully funded by Mr. Shardul Shroff. I would like to. This is a very significant development because we have research on urban issues in some specialized institutions. But to study the challenges and opportunities of urbanization in an institute which looks at development as a whole and looks at these challenges in the context of opening up the Indian economy is something which is unique, and for the first time ICRIER would be doing that. The third landmark that ICRIER is going to achieve this year is that we have received some land from the Ministry of Urban Development a few years ago, and we've been engaged in building, in developing a green building in our new premises, where actually the expansion of ICRIER can be accommodated. So we will retain our present location at the Habitat Center and have this new building in Saket area. And we have been raising funding for this building. And for that, in the past, We've had donors, donations of 1 crore each from the State Bank of India, ICICI, Kotak Mahindra Bank, Fortis, Bharti Enterprises, Nandan and Rohini Nilekani, and ITC, SR, Financial Technologies and DLF. And most recently, in the last week, we have received commitments and payments from 3 new donors. We have Rohan Murthy making a commitment of 1 crore towards our building fund. We have Biocon making a commitment, similar commitment. And we have the Trident Group of industries based in Punjab and Madhya Pradesh. Again, we've made a payment of 1 crore to this building fund. We hope to move into our building by before Diwali, by end September. Now, finally, to the sixth K.B. Lal lecture, we are indeed extremely delighted that from his very, very busy schedule, Dr. Raghuram Rajan has taken the time to come all the way and speak to this event, which means a great deal to ICRIA. Dr. Rajan does not need any introduction, but he is not only the 23rd governor of the Reserve Bank. Before that, he was chief economic advisor when we saw a lot of him in Delhi. And prior to that, he was Eric J. Gleacher, Distinguished Service Professor of Finance at the University of Chicago's Booth School. He was chief economist at the IMF from 2003 to 2006. His work covers a broad range of areas. A lot of us know him with his book titled Saving Capitalism from the Capitalists, which came out in 2003. For his book Fault Lines, How Hidden Fractures Still Threaten the World Economy, he was awarded the Financial Times Goldman Sachs Prize for the best business book in 2010, and the topic for today's lecture is very close to what he had presented in the book. So we will see an update of 5 years from the time this much acclaimed book came out. Dr. Rajan is a member of the Group of 30. He's a member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. He was president of the American Finance Association in 2011. In 2003, the American Finance Association awarded Dr. Rajan the inaugural Fisher Black Prize for the best finance researcher under the age of 40. The other awards he has received include the Global Indian of the Year Award from NASSCOM in 2011, the Infosys Prize for Economic Sciences in 2012, the Center for Financial Studies and Deutsche Bank Prize for Financial Economics in 2013, and the Central Bank Governor of the Year Award by Euro Money Magazine in 2014, and numerous others that he doesn't tell us and we don't know of. But I must end by saying that when he received the Infosys Prize in economics in 2011, he donated that prize to ICRIA and asked us to use this money to send 2 postdoc scholars from India to the NBER summer school in the US. And we have done that diligently. We were able to do that for 4 years. We have multiple connections. We are very proud of you, Dr. Rajan, and I will now not stand between you and the audience and invite you to deliver the lecture.
Dr. Ishwar Aluwalia, Dr. Rajat Kathuria, distinguished guests, It is a great pleasure to deliver this lecture on Dr. K.B. Lal's 100th birth anniversary. Now, typically I get called to give name lectures, people I've never met. Often I've heard of, but sometimes not. This time it's for someone that father of a good friend, but also who has indeed affected my life. And let me explain why. Dr. K.B. Lal was ambassador of India in Brussels in 1970, in the early 1970s. And my father was posted in the Indian embassy there. And we were returning to India in 1974. And as kids, at that point, the Foreign Service didn't pay particularly well. So we studied in a French school. In French medium. And we were coming back to India where schools taught in English and Hindi was a language that people were expected to know, and we hadn't learned any Hindi there. So a lot of trepidation. Even at that time, entrance into Delhi schools was extremely difficult, especially the good ones, and they all had exams. So Dr. K.B. Lal had sent a letter along with my mother. My mother was sent as an advance party to get us admission. And we went to Delhi Public School, Arkepuram, which was a new school at that point. Now, of course, it's the school in Delhi, but it was a new school. And she went with the letter to Principal Lugani. And three scruffy young kids, my elder brother, sister, and myself, sort of were ushered into the room. And he proceeded to ask each one of us a question. None of us were able to answer the question that he asked. And having determined that we knew nothing, he proceeded to give us admission. I think that was on the strength of the letter that Dr. K.B. Lal had written. Presumably it said something nice about us. Nevertheless, that did open Delhi Public School Arkepuram to us, and I think it made a big difference in my education. So thank you to Dr. K.B. Lal for that. And that's why when Rajiv asked me if I'd give the lecture, I had absolutely no hesitation in saying yes. Now, what I want to speak about is really a topic on which, as Ishar has already said, Dr. K.B. Lal did a fair amount of pushing in India, thinking about India and the open economy. And I want to talk about this in the current context of the world economy, what's happening, and what are the things we need to be worried about and how we adapt, as well as what opportunities will emerge. Now, as many of you know, the IMF has been coming out over the last few years with gloomier and gloomier forecasts. They changed the rationale for these forecasts over time. Early on, it was thought to be decoupling. The emerging markets were doing fantastically well. The industrial countries were doing badly. And then it switched. The industrial countries started picking up, and the emerging markets started doing badly. And then there were some revisions and so on. The point I think that we take away from all this is we really don't understand well what's happening in the global economy. Why is it that we have this multi-speed outlook? Now, there are explanations floating around. For example, within industrial countries, the countries that seem to have emerged more strongly are the ones that deleveraged early, deleveraged quickly, cleaned up their banking system. The US is an example. And others who took more time in doing that, and therefore, and perhaps had more debt to deal with, and therefore were late in this process. Now, within emerging markets, again, the countries that responded with substantial, significant stimulus, especially debt-fueled stimulus post-crisis, are the ones in trouble now. I won't take names, but you can guess who they are. Also, the countries that most recently have been commodity producers have been hit relative to the commodity consumers. Fortunately for us, we did some stimulus, but not a huge amount. We did have some leveraged spending. But we also are commodity consumers. So on net, we seem to be in a much better place than many of our emerging market colleagues. The point, however, is that there's something going on that we don't fully understand. These are explanations of individual cases. There's always an explanation you can find. But what is responsible for this recovery being so slow across the world? Now, if you ask Ken Rogoff and Carmen Reinhart, they would argue that this is all part of the deleveraging process, that as debt comes down, economies take time to pick up. You could add to that that perhaps the period of debt buildup was also responsible, that we got extra growth pre-crisis because it was fueled by the American consumer who was taking on debt, the Greek government that was taking on debt, and sundry other entities that borrowed to spend. And post-crisis, they were not able to do that. So not only were they not able to spend anymore, they started deleveraging and spent less. That is part of the answer. And of course, in emerging markets, we grew at that time on the basis of very strong exports to these countries that were willing to spend. And as soon as they stopped spending, it started rebounding back on us. There is a need for emerging markets to change the export-led growth model because there's nobody to export to at the end of that model. That's sort of the quick and dirty explanation that is sometimes floating around. But there are other explanations that we still need to elaborate a little better. One, of course, is population aging. We still don't quite understand what has been happening in Japan, because it's the first country that experienced significant aging. And we still don't understand why it has been slow for the last 20 years. And some people argue maybe it's not been slow. Maybe with a population which is aging, where the labor force is declining, you should measure growth relative to the declining population. In other words, if the population is declining, the labor force is declining 2% a year, your normal GDP growth should be minus 2%, and you should tabulate things from that. So recession is negative 2% and below, and anything above that is actually positive growth. You need to adjust for population aging. And some people have made that kind of comment. But we also don't understand, if in fact you have population aging, what it does to things like savings and investments, and I'll come back to this a little later. And maybe it is aging in Germany, aging in Japan, aging in China now, all of which are contributing to slower global demand, global final demand, both investments and saving. But overlaid on this issue of aging is this issue of slowing productivity. Some of you may have read Robert Gordon's book. His thesis is that in this age of Twitter and Facebook and so on, we think we're doing wonderful new innovations, but this is nothing compared to the innovations at the beginning of the 20th century, the combustion engine, the aircraft, even the simple thing like an iron, which enables you to iron on the basis of electricity rather than fill big, fat, heavy contraptions with coal, and which some of our istrivalas still do. But this made a big difference in the lives of housewives. They were largely housewives then, and so on. That's a thesis out there. Many people believe that it's probably overstating the case. There is a fair amount of development of growth right now, but why isn't it not showing up in the numbers? Why, with all this talk about innovation, and innovation is there in biotech, innovation is there in IT, even in financial services, there's tremendous innovation in India in the financial services. Why is this not showing up in the GDP numbers? So some people argue it's a measurement problem. Today's car is so much better than a car 20 years ago. It does all sorts of things. It's probably much safer. There are airbags, this and that. But when we compare today's car as a unit of output, we don't adjust for that higher quality. And as a result, we tend to think of a car today as a car yesterday, but in fact, a car today is a car yesterday plus something more, because it's so much better. Just as today's airplanes don't go any faster, the normal commercial airline doesn't go any faster than airplanes 20 years ago, but air crashes are far less frequent now because there's so much more safety, so much more comfort built in. So maybe the problem is a measurement problem. We're not measuring quality properly. And as a result, quality today is much better than quality yesterday. There's growth embedded in that quality. We're not producing more cars, but we're producing better cars. And therefore, there is growth that's not being picked up. And to Surjit, who complains about GDP numbers, the complaints are everywhere, right? Not just in India. Second possibility is the monetization problem. So one is measurement problem of GDP. The second is monetization problem, that perhaps what is really happening is a lot of stuff we used to pay for earlier, which we don't pay for today. And so we receive those products free, they're not measured in the economy. And let me be very careful about this because I got into trouble for saying this in the past. The concept of GDP, and I'm not talking about Indian measurement of GDP, I'm talking about the global theoretical concept of GDP, if you don't pay for it, doesn't show up in GDP. So for example, if a lady is working at home, she doesn't get a salary, she's not thought of as contributing to GDP. If she walks across the street and works in her neighbor's house and her neighbor comes and works in her house, both of them get exactly the same salary, so they even out. GDP has increased by the sum of their salaries. That's a problem with the concept of GDP. And if we are replacing movies that you go to the movie theater to pay for by YouTube videos that you see on your computer, which are not paid for, the enjoyment may be greater seeing the YouTube video because it's more tailored to your taste. Value has gone up, utility has gone up, but GDP has come down. Okay? So again, a monetization problem. Maybe it's a matter of time before people figure out how to charge for YouTube videos. But today, we download them and have no problem doing it. So that may be another reason for low productivity. A third problem could be the zombie problem. Zombie problem is that you have all these firms that, you know, post financial crisis, because we rescued the banking system, because we cut interest rates tremendously, etc., are subsisting because the cost of capital is very, very low, and they're not put out of their misery. And in fact, they are producing. When in fact it would be better if they were cleaned out of the system. Good recessions are necessary to clean the system, at least according to some theories. And perhaps the recession post-global financial crisis was not deep enough to effect that cleansing. This is sometimes derided as a liquidationist theory after, I think it was Andrew Mellon, the US Treasury Secretary during the Depression, who said liquidate as a solution to get things back up. But there is some possibility that if you don't actually put firms out of the misery, they keep prices relatively low, they are in a zombie state, they're not really alive, they're not really dead, and they keep new entry from happening, they keep investment from happening. This certainly was a situation in Japan post their crisis. Some people argue it could be some of the problem today preventing global investment. This fourth argument that sometimes is made, the Economist has been making this quite strongly, that perhaps nature of new production technologies, the network effects, for example, the intellectual capital that goes into some of our processes may in fact create more oligopolistic industries. And not just oligopolistic industries within countries, but oligopolistic industries across the world. Think of all these major internet providers, the Facebooks, the Googles, etc. They do command a very large market because of network effects. And one of the concerns that has been expressed is many industries have far fewer players today than they had in the past, and more oligopolistic industries means higher prices than you would otherwise have, lower efficiency, lower growth. And maybe that's part of what the problem is. But as you can see, these are all plausible arguments, and we really don't know how these play out and how they fit together. All we do know is the final outcome is, again and again, we're surprised by relatively slow growth, and part of this relatively slow growth is a shifting crisis. Crisis initially in the industrial countries because of the substantial stimulus in a number of emerging markets, as well as in some countries, political difficulties. That crisis has shifted over to the emerging markets. We're playing musical crisis in this world. So what do we do? What is our solution to this? The truth is, we don't have a real global solution, other than saying, and this is the IMF mantra, for those who have easy monetary policy, keep your foot firmly pressed on the accelerator. Don't take it off, because you know, with everything else that's happening, this is not a good time to tighten. And of course, whoever can do more fiscal stimulus should do more fiscal stimulus. And anybody who has political room to do structural reforms should do structural reforms. So this is the prescription. In some sense, you get the feeling that the policy prescriptions would remain the same regardless of what the true cause was. Pick any of these causes, the policy prescription would remain the same. And the question is, should we try and get a little deeper into what's going on, try and understand better to have a better chance of success, especially if we're going to coordinate action as we sometimes do at these global meetings. So for example, if we're talking structural reforms, is anything that moves the needle on growth useful? And you know, the global community seems to be saying yes, which is why we have a grab bag of reforms put together, all countries promising I'll do this, I'll do that, typically things that they've already done so that they're not held to any additional commitments. But it adds up to a push on growth. Now, the question you have to ask is any country doing less than it can on growth? In these difficult times, every country is doing whatever it can. It's hard to think of any country that is sort of holding back, of course, modulo political room, but everybody is exercising the maximum political room that they have for the growth that they need. And so, to my mind, these kinds of exercises where you get a lot of countries to commit to additional growth is unlikely to produce any real additional growth, because countries are pretty much doing what they can. But there is a value to try to understand whether there are common factors slowing down the world. And if there are these common factors, and it does seem there are common factors, because the same factors are slow exports mirrored with slow exports in the rest of Asia, does seem that these common factors might be worth addressing. So a grab bag of reforms where each country does what it can on its own may not have as much impact as trying to understand what these common factors are and trying to devote whatever scarce political capital we have today to addressing those. What I'm talking about here is not so much a coordinated global movement, but a coordinated understanding of what the problem is, and then each individual country actually does what it can to move in that direction. For example, if the problem is oligopolistic industries built around protected intellectual property or built around network effects, can we have a better global dialogue on regulatory practices that would make some of these industries more competitive? that may have more value in these international meetings than basically countries exhorting each other to do all the structural reforms domestically that they can, which again, as I said, it's hard for me to believe that no country is doing the maximum it can. A second point where there is a global sort of effect and where we need to think about whether we have gone in the right direction to the extent needed, whether we need to do more or we need to back off, is bank regulation. As you know, post-financial crisis, bankers were seen as the villains of the peace, and clearly they did not help their case by clamoring for bonuses soon after, even while Main Street was, in many countries, was in deep difficulty. It's clear that we needed more regulation at that point, and I think we got some under the aegis of the Basel Committee. Question is, has there been sufficient re-regulation of the banking sector? Are we in danger of going too far? Regulation is often pro-cyclical. When the bad times hit, we say, oh, we've made a mistake, let's regulate, we regulate, until we've gone too far, then the good times start happening, we deregulate, until we go too far again. So it's a pendulum. Have we gone too far on regulating the banks? Let me give you three or four places where I think we have to worry. One issue which a number of bank regulators are concerned about is that even while monetary policy, and I'll come to that in a minute, has created the potential for large asset price movements, because monetary policy today is focused on boosting asset prices. To some extent, that's the rationale behind QE, perhaps even beyond what fundamentals warrant. But even while those asset prices have been boosted, market making and liquidity in those markets is drying up because bankers aren't willing to play market maker anymore. That requires capital investment, which is costly, and they're backing off from that. So you have a dangerous situation where asset prices may have moved more than fundamentals, but the ability to take the other side, to provide liquidity to the market when the asset prices move, is more limited. So you could get sharp asset price movements, and sharp asset price movements invariably create trouble in the economy, especially for levered players. So that's one question. Have we moved too far in backing banks out of market making? And as a result, especially in an environment where monetary policy is very aggressive, created the potential for larger asset price volatility. Second, we know how to regulate banks. And you know, like the famous economist searching under the lamp for the keys, when in fact the keys have been dropped in the shade, in the dark, but there's no light there. We know how to regulate banks, so we've regulated them. But we don't know how to regulate the shadow financial system, so we haven't regulated that as much. What happens if you put a lot of pressure on a balloon on one side? It balloons out on the other side. So is there a danger that by regulating the banks so strongly, we have shifted activity, not just activity, not just risky activity, but human capital to the shadow banking system? That's a real question. And it's not necessary that, and the old argument was, yes, we may have, but that's the unlevered part. So it's okay. It's not a bad thing. But remember, you know, shifting activity may, in fact, if it's risky activity, that may be a good thing. But if you've shifted the smart people also out of the banks into the shadow financial system, I don't know if a less smart bank is less risky. Now, some people would argue that it was the smart guys who actually took the banks down. But the smart guys also do the risk management. The smart guys also do the project evaluation. Is a less smart banking system more of a risk or less of a risk? That's a question we should ask ourselves. Certainly, you know, one of the ideas or the intent behind the regulation was to reduce the complexity and the financial engineering that was creating risks for the banking system. But in that process, have you also reduced the ability of banks to take needed real sector risks anymore? And that's again a question we have to ask. If you know, we're saying, where's the real investment? Where is economic growth? But even while we're asking that question, we have regulations which could, again, have the potential to pull banks from taking on real risk. For example, small and medium enterprise lending. From the perspective of an emerging market, we see it in cross-border lending into the emerging market or in foreign bank expansion. One of the things you see a definite slowdown is in the expansion of branches of foreign banks in India. That has slowed down tremendously since the crisis. And one could argue that this is a fallout of the global financial crisis and the regulation, because after all, at the end of it, we are a BAA country. And therefore, any entity within a BAA country comes up against the country ceiling. And so loans cross-border into our country tend to be seen as risky, require greater capital, and that could impair lending into the country. Those are three questions I've asked. Let me add a fourth. If, in fact, activity has moved to the shadow banking system, and there is a liquidity shortage like we had during the global financial crisis, do the right players have access to central bank windows anymore? Banks have access to central bank windows, but we move the risk to the non-banks. If the non-banks have the risk, but they don't have access to the window, do we have the ability to cope with a financial crisis of the kind we saw in 2007-2008? I think it's worth asking these questions. This lecture is a lot about questions, and I'm not going to say we know the answers, but I think it's really important that we start asking about the answers and see, because to my mind, if 7 or 8 years after the crisis we still haven't got strong growth, a mantra which says do what you did yesterday looks a lot like what the generals did in World War I. You know the story in the trenches facing each other. There's always send more troops over the top. And the troops got more down by the machine guns. And it was, we didn't send enough last time, let's send even more. And we have the same story again. We didn't do enough on policy, let's do more of the same kind of policy. Maybe it's time to start thinking, are there other reasons why we're growing so slowly, and what could they be? Let me come to my last issue here before I come to the emerging markets, which is, could monetary policy, easy and unconventional monetary policy, increasingly be part of the problem? Now, I want to start by saying it was part of the solution post-financial crisis. Liquidity provision was extremely important. However, what was done then has continued, not just low for long, but increasingly inventive, innovative policies. And I think increasingly, I've been preaching from the, been a little bit of a Cassandra about this for some time, but increasingly more people are coming to the view that negative interest rates, whole new talk about helicopter money, these are beyond the pale. That in fact they may have perverse effects and not the effects that people postulate. But low for long, aggressive monetary policy for a long time, could it have essentially run out of steam? And I've already pointed to one effect of very low and easy, very low cost and easy capital, which is the inefficient firms don't get turfed out. But there are other effects. Remember, we talked about population aging. If you are in your 50s, you've just lost a ton of money in the global financial crisis. You're preparing for retirement. You like fixed income because you don't trust stocks anymore. And you want short maturity fixed income because you don't trust the long maturity anymore, because the central banks are all over that space. You have a target end of life savings. end of working life savings. You want double of what you have right now. What happens if the government reduces interest rates? You say, yippee, interest rates are really low, I can borrow and spend, and you go out into the market and buy anything that you like. Or do you say, well, the global financial crisis taught me a lesson. Things go up, things go down. Maybe I need to save more for my end of life retirement goal. And low interest rates mean I have to save even more, because income is really hard to come by. So what you have is a backward bending interest rate curve in the language of economists. The lower the interest rate, the more the saving rather than less the saving. People aren't going out and celebrating when interest rates get cut. They're actually saving more because they need their pensions. They worry about the viability of government-funded pensions and so on. There is a more sophisticated version of this, which some of you economic students here might recognize, called Ricardian equivalence, which is basically saying we all know the piper has to be paid at some point. And so if debt levels increase in a country, eventually instead of encouraging more spending, people start saving, knowing the tax burden to pay down that debt at some point has to fall on somebody. That's a different, slightly different version of what I'm saying, but they all amount to the same thing. You could have perverse effects of very low interest rates, perverse effects of substantial fiscal stimulus. These things eventually run out of steam. And of course, if you've moved asset prices to a place where people think it may be contrary to fundamentals, the fear of the volatility when those asset prices settle down again to fundamentals, again, impels more savings. Today, it's hard to think in the international economic setting of which assets you think are free of mispricing. I'm not saying they mispriced. I'm saying there's a lot of uncertainty about mispricing given the extremely, extremely aggressive monetary policy. In that kind of environment where you're not confident of asset prices, the tendency would be to save more rather than to save less. Of course, the side of aggressive monetary policy that we see in an emerging market is that this also prompts capital flows. Now, many of your reporters talk about risk on, risk off. Now, risk on, risk off is not driven by the emerging markets for the most part. Yes, occasionally there's an emerging market event which prompts investors abroad to reconsider their options. But typically risk on, risk off comes from the industrial countries, what is happening there. And in these risk on moments, we get a flood of capital. We don't know what to do with it. It strengthens the exchange rate. The Brazilian finance minister, former finance minister Mantegna, complained about currency wars as the Brazilian real appreciated tremendously and caused a significant current account deficit in Brazil, only to see the money flowing out and a huge depreciation since then in Brazil. So capital flows do tend to follow sentiment, not always fundamentals. And the flip side of capital coming in is it tends to leave at some point with significant currency depreciation and associated effects. Now, emerging markets don't like currency depreciation that much. But for industrial countries, it could be a boon. If I see my currency depreciate and inflation is relatively constant, I become more competitive and I can export more. Now, a third concern with aggressive monetary policy is that one of the primary channels through which it might work is by depreciating the exchange rate, right? Now you may say, what's wrong with that? What's wrong with depreciating your exchange rate? Well, in an environment of weak global demand, when I depreciate my exchange rate, I'm making my goods more attractive to the other country's citizens. But those citizens in that country, they already have weak demand. And what we're doing is essentially taking their demand from them by depreciating our exchange rate. So if that country's authorities see this happening, what do? They say, well, we better depreciate our exchange rate. And what you have is comparative depreciation. This was actually a big concern during the Great Depression. These are called beggar thy neighbor strategies. You depreciate in order to take demand from the others. Now, no industrial country today, at least thus far, except for the for Switzerland, has directly targeted its exchange rate. Sweden is talking about doing it, but no country has done it. However, if in fact your interest rate sensitive segments, when you cut interest rates, they don't expand demand, your consumers aren't going out and buying, your firms aren't going out and investing, the primary effect of cutting your interest rate may be to depreciate your currency rather than to generate domestic demand. Now, monetary policy always got a free pass because you generated domestic demand, even though your exchange rate depreciated and you took demand from others, you also contributed to global demand because your domestic demand went up when you cut interest rates. If today domestic demand is not moving up, you're not generating any domestic demand, but you're shifting demand from other countries, your policy, monetary policy, may also be suspect. It may be a policy which essentially should be proscribed by the international community because it's demand shifting rather than demand creating. Now, I think these are possibilities. The question is there a reason why this might become more acute in these times? And I want to end this discussion about monetary policy by saying yes. And that's because we have a number of inflation targeting countries across the world or regimes across the world. One of the issues with inflation targeting is you have a problem with if inflation exceeds the upper bound. That's the problem that we have been more focused on in India because we have high inflation. But you also have a problem if inflation falls below the lower bound. This is a problem in industrial countries. Now, when inflation threatens to fall below the lower bound, central banks could throw up their hands and say, look, we really can't do very much more. We've done everything we can. Interest rates are at zero. We can do nothing more. However, in recent times, we have one magic solution if interest rates fall below the lower bound. And that's called the helicopter drop of money. Now, for those of you who don't know what a helicopter drop is, take money, print it by central bank, put it in a helicopter, take it up, throw the money out of the helicopter, falls all around, people find money, go out and spend because it's their lucky day. And you get growth, you get spending, you get inflation pushed up, and everybody's happy, right? At least that's the theory. And so with the helicopter drop as a nuclear option,